be limited to 3 pages in length, and the OIDP will include all properly submitted written comments in the meeting minutes. Next slide, please. Our highlights for today, we're going to start off with talking about advancing novel coronavirus vaccines. We're going to talk about approaches to including pregnant women in COVID-19 vaccine trials, talk a bit about vaccine safety systems in COVID-19, have an important comment from CMS about no copays and coverage for COVID-19 vaccines, followed by a review of our response to the charge, public comment, charge discussion, and our vote. If you go to the next slide, please. I hope that you all have our upcoming meetings on your calendars, February 4th to 5th, 2021, June 16-17, and September 15-16. Hopefully, we will be able to at least participate in the majority of those face-to-face, but if not, this is at least a reasonable backup plan. And our schedule is also posted on the HHS.gov website. You'd go to the next slide, please. So our next event, we're pleased to have Dr. Stanley Plotkin here with us. He is an emeritus professor in the University of Pennsylvania, and is also done a lot of consulting work for vaccine manufacturers. He's going to provide his thoughts about vaccinating children and learning from COVID-19 vaccine development. Dr. Plotkin, thank you for joining us. You have the floor.
Right. Do you hear me?
I hear you.
Okay. Well, I don't see. Yes. Okay.
There you are. I see you.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Okay. Not that you need to see me, but anyway. All right. So I've been asked to comment on why I think children should eventually receive vaccines against SARS-2. Now, of course, there are populations that need vaccines against the coronavirus before children. There's no doubt about that. But ultimately, in my view, children should be included in vaccination. Now, I was asked to do this relatively recently, and I hope that I am correctly responding to what you want. But I do have a couple of slides about pregnancy. Pregnancy does, as far as I can tell from the literature, does not seem to be primarily a problem of infection of the fetus, but rather infection of the pregnant woman, who obviously late in pregnancy has less respiratory reserve than in a non-pregnant state. And I'm just, without dwelling on this, I am simply going to show a few references to this subject, which leads me to the view that I've just stated, that this is not primarily a problem like rubella or cytomegalovirus. I think you can see from the titles of the slides the point that I am just stating. So I'll just move on to the next slide then. And these references may be useful to you simply in terms of consideration of immunization in a pregnancy. Of course, we tend not to vaccinate in pregnancy because of concerns relating to the fetus. So far, it does not appear that we have any specific issue with a SARS-2 vaccine in that regard, especially an activated vaccine. It's true that we don't have a lot of evidence from for messenger RNA vaccines, and they will have to be tested in pregnancy. And in general, of course, we tend to try to avoid vaccinating in the first trimester of pregnancy out of an abundance of caution, even though there is little or no evidence that any vaccine given in the first trimester, aside from live vaccines, could be harmful. Let me move then to what I think is the important issue, and that is the vaccination of children. If I could move on to the next slide. This slide also is useful in terms of saying that although children were mostly asymptomatic, there were symptoms in normal children. That is, cough and fever and pharyngitis, as well as other respiratory symptoms. And it says that children rarely needed admission to intensive care units, and yet this series had 3%. I don't consider that to be rare. Although children do not seem to have a lot of serious disease, as do adults, and of course, particularly the elderly, yet they are not protected completely against serious SARS-2 disease. Next slide. Here is another review of the situation. It does point out that, again, that although they looked at quite a large group of children, 7,480, again, about 2% of the children were admitted to pediatric intensive care. There was very low mortality, 0.08%, but nevertheless, a dead child is not a happy thing. That again, children are not totally immune. Interestingly, a higher proportion of newborns was severely ill, 12%, with dyspnea. That perhaps might be an argument to vaccinating pregnant women in order to pass their antibodies to the fetus. But again, my overall point is that infection in children is not totally asymptomatic. My last slide in this regard is the next one. Here there was a series of over 1,000 children. 14% were asymptomatic in this series, but among those that were ill, whereas 36% were mild, 46% were moderate, and 2.1% were severe, with 1.2% being critically ill. So these reviews are consistent in that about 1 or 2% of children are having significant disease. And if you think about other infections in childhood, for Haemophilus influenza, meningitis, for example, that incidence would not be out of line. My point being that if one is vaccinating against, let's say, Haemophilus, that this might also be an indication for vaccination of children. So my last slide is the one that I want to linger on. That is the overall point about why I think eventually, once there is enough vaccine, that children should be vaccinated. And the first point is the one that I've made repetitively now, that although I'm sorry I use the word rare, but I don't think it's rare, although uncommon, serious disease does occur in children. That is, COVID-19 disease does occur in children. Second, children, when they become infected, excrete virus. And therefore, they could be the agent to infect parents, teachers, and other children. And of course, this is an argument that applies to other vaccines as well, that is justifying vaccination in children. A third point is that inasmuch as infection in children is often asymptomatic, as in other young people, we have no way of knowing who's infected, which child is infected, and which child, therefore, is capable of infecting other people. And then, under the condition that vaccines against SARS-2 do give long-lasting immunity, or at least priming for an accelerated response to the virus, the child will still be resistant after growing up. And that is an important point because as we cannot count on universal vaccination of adults, vaccination of children will eventually result in an immune population. Just as is the case with other agents for which we vaccinate. So, in summary, my argument is that if we are, if assuming that SARS-2 virus becomes a permanent threat, that we are going to have to include children in our plans for vaccination in order to maintain control of the epidemic, to protect people who are likely to have serious disease, such as grandparents, but also to protect the children themselves. And I would also add, it's not on this slide, but in thinking about this, at least in the US, the possibility of making vaccination against SARS-2 mandatory is an important point because, of course, that's what we do with other vaccines in childhood. The argument being that that is the best way to protect our innocent children. And by the way, also to protect the population at large. So now I admit that this is an early statement that we do not yet know which vaccines would be the optimal vaccines for children. And there are other aspects of the disease that we're just learning about. But looking ahead, and I think we should always do that. Looking ahead, I do believe that children should eventually be vaccinated. And I will stop there.
Thank you, Dr. Plotkin. Very helpful remarks.
I'm
A couple of minutes ahead of time.
Dr. Hopkins, it's a little hard to hear you.
Turn up my microphone here. Thank you for your remarks, Dr. Plotkin. That was very helpful. We're running a bit ahead of time. Do any of the members of the committee have a question or comment for Dr. Plotkin before we move forward?
Bob, it's Tim Cook. I do,
Please, Tim, go
but
ahead.
it's not related to the question about pregnancy in children. So, it I hope I'm not barging in on other people's questions that may be. But one of our charges, and let me, here, I'll show my screen. Sorry. One of the charges that NVAC has from the ASH is to make recommendations on what lessons were learned from COVID-19 vaccine development and how we can use these in the future to promote innovation and shorten timelines. So Dr. Plotkin, it's great to have you back at NVAC again. And I wondered if, you know, you've been at this a long time and whether you had thoughts on, you know, what lessons will be learned. And I know it's these would be the early lessons so far, and there's a lot more lessons to be learned about how we can innovate more around vaccine development in the future. But if you could share any thoughts, we'd really appreciate it.
Well, so thank you for those questions, which are big, big questions. What has struck me about this experience are basically two things. One, that fortunately, and in part because of financing by the federal government, all hands are on deck. That is to say, all of the platforms that are used to develop vaccines, including, of course, the newer ones, are being used to develop the vaccines against SARS-2, and that is great. I mean, that shows that given an emergency, the scientific community can respond rapidly, and in the event of another disease, I'll come back to that. That the industry, so to speak, and academia will respond. That is assuming that they get enough support, financial support, from the government. Although not every organization has needed that, but most have. The second point is one that goes back a bit. In 2015, I believe it was, I wrote an article with Jeremy Farrar from the Wellcome Trust. I wrote an article that in the New England Journal that proposed the development of an organization to deal with emerging infections, to develop vaccines against emerging infections. And that was because of the Ebola experience. And fortunately, that idea, which wasn't really that brilliant, but it took off. And now we have CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness and Innovation. They are financing some of the vaccines for against COVID, and they are financing development of vaccines against many other infections that for which there's no commercial interest. I think we have to pursue that in the future. If you look at all of the agents which are now in animals, some of which are obviously capable of jumping to humans, such as SARS-2, we could start vaccine development now, assuming that there's enough financial support. And we now have an organization that could handle that. So my second perception, if you will, is that we have a way now to try to deal with emerging infections at an early point before they become a pandemic, such as SARS-2. And we should take advantage of that opportunity. So I've tried to answer your question as much as I can.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Pluck. And I think that's definitely one of the lessons learned in here, and how to use the partnerships like CEPI to be able to combat these different emerging infections as quickly as we can. I also think it's a great opportunity to have so many different vaccine platforms, and particularly new platforms like mRNA and some of the recombinant live virals, go at the same, you know, the same target at the same time. And I can't help but think we're going to learn a tremendous amount about which platforms are good for either getting there quickly or getting there cheaply, or, you know, being stored at reasonable temperatures and all of that. So I think it'll be very interesting.
You know, I do think that the U.S. government has to think hard about their ability to handle this. I'm not saying that the federal response was poor, definitely was not poor, but I think it was somewhat disorganized at the beginning. And so again, my emphasis is being ready for this type of event. You know, when you think about it, there's been Ebola, Zika, SARS-2, and others, and they've been recent. You know, that's not going back to the 1918 influenza. These are recent events, chikungunya, and we should be able to deal with these in a better way than we have been.
Okay, well, thanks so much. I'll stop there, and sorry if I've intruded on some questions about pregnancy and children, but thank you, Dr. Plotkin.
Bob, this is Cody Meissner. Can I ask a question?
Cody, I think Daniel looks like he was up before you, and then I'll put you next.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, Cody, for being patient. And thank you, Dr. Plotkin, for your wonderful comments. I think we all are thinking that it's important to be vaccinating children, pregnant females at some point, but also that we are wanting to be very careful about when. The sort of general concept, I think, is we need to have plenty of safety data in the adults first before we really contemplate this in a big way in these special populations. But I just wondered if I could ask for more granularity in your opinion on the timing of it. I think what we are thinking is that certainly after EUA as a minimum on some vaccine. But I'm just wondering what you would think about starting clinical trials in these populations, bridging trials in kids and in pregnant females, starting as soon as possible after EUA is given, or would you wait until there's actual official licensure of a vaccine?
Well, thank you for that question. Oops.
We can hear you.
Yeah, thank you. I don't know what's happening here, but thank you for that question. And I entirely agree that trials should be started now, because we have, I think, already, at least with several of the vaccines, sufficient evidence of safety in adults. So I think we have the right to start vaccinating children so that we have the clinical data after all of the other populations have been vaccinated. And if I understand correctly, by the middle of 2021, all of the target populations will have been offered vaccination. So we should start soon in children, so that we have clinical data by, let's say, the second half of 2021, and can then decide whether to push ahead or not.
Thank you. I think Cody will probably follow up on that.
Thank you, Dan. And thank you, Dr. Plotkin. It's always an educational experience to hear your comments. I would like to ask you what your thoughts are about the mRNA vaccines. That is, it seems quite interesting that both vaccines came up with efficacy rates that are pretty similar, of 95%. And it seems to me we should interpret that as reassuring that, in fact, these vaccines are going to be effective, at least in the short term. And do you have any thoughts about how durable that immunity might be, in thinking in comparison that the conventional coronaviruses, which we've all known about for many years, the immunity tends to wane? And do you think it might be different with this virus?
So, Cody, that's a good question, and I can only give a very partial answer, because the two main things we don't know yet are, can we prevent mucosal replication of the virus with the vaccines, and how long will our protection last? Or to put it another way, what is the correlate of protection? How much assuming it's neutralizing antibody, how much neutralizing antibody does one need? Actually, the mRNA vaccines have been so effective that the data from them is probably not going to allow much in the way of a conclusion about that. But the data with the AstraZeneca adenovirus vaccine should allow us to determine whether or what the level of neutralizing antibody is that is protective. I hope I'm right. I assume that there are specimens available to measure neutralization after vaccination, and then to look at who got infected and who didn't. So all I can say about the mRNA vaccines is there is evidence of B cell memory. But again, we don't know yet what level of antibody is necessary. But it's, of course, as you know, it's complicated. It could be that having memory would allow an anamnestic response to occur at the time of exposure, and therefore a protection to occur even though antibodies have waned. But there are so many factors that we need to know. With this disease has a relatively short incubation period. And unfortunately, for as a generalization with vaccines, those with short incubation periods cannot rely on memory. So, you know, I don't know the answer to your question. And I can only know after we have more data. And incidentally, if I can, you know, ring a bell, that's one of the arguments for human challenges, to determine what is the duration of immunity after vaccination in vaccinated people. It is a key question. There's no doubt about that.
Thank you.
Dr. Plotkin, thank you. You always teach us. I don't think I've ever heard you speak where I haven't learned at least two or three new things. Thank you for your input today, sir.
I thank you very much, and I assume it's safe for me to just to close off, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Our next endeavor is a panel on approaches to including pregnant women in COVID-19 clinical trials. We have four speakers and also have a couple of other experts that will be on the line to help with answering questions. We're going to start with Dr. Sasha Ellington from CDC. Dr. Ellington is an epidemiologist at CDC and co-lead on the COVID-19 Response Pregnancy and Infant Linked Outcomes Team. She'll be followed by Dr. Ruth Faden from Johns Hopkins. Dr. Faden is the Philip Franklin Wagley Professor of Biomedical Ethics and the founding director of the Johns Hopkins Berman's Institute. Next will be Dr. Jeff Roberts from Food and Drug Administration, where he's Associate Director for Scientific Affairs in the Office of Vaccines Research and Review. Then Dr. Linda Eckert from the University of Washington and representing the American College of OBGYN. She's Professor of OBGYN at the University of Washington. And then Dr. Dana Meany-Dellum from CDC will be on the line to answer questions. She's the co-lead of the Vaccine Task Force and COVID-19 Response. And Dr. Titi Odoyibo from CDC, who's Medical Officer in the CDC COVID-19 Response. We want to thank all of you for your participation in our committee meeting and to help us with our deliberations. I'll now turn the floor over to Dr. Ellington.
Hi, can you hear me?
I hear you, Dr. Ellington.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Sasha Ellington. I'm an epidemiologist with the Pregnancy and Infant Linked Outcomes Team on CDC's COVID-19 Response. I'm going to provide a brief update on the epidemiology of COVID-19 in pregnancy and CDC's surveillance activities. Next slide, please. So to start with a very brief background, it is well established that there are physiologic changes in pregnancy that could increase the risk of severe respiratory viral illness in pregnant women. And these include, but are not limited to, increased heart rate and oxygen consumption, decreased lung capacity, and the shift away from cell-mediated immunity. Severe disease has been associated with other viral respiratory infections during pregnancy, such as with influenza. Next slide. A living systematic review and meta-analysis published in September synthesizes the literature on COVID-19 and pregnancy fairly well. The review sought to identify risk factors for severe COVID-19 illness during pregnancy and delivery and to report on the adverse outcomes among mothers and infants. Differences in clinical manifestations of the disease in pregnant versus similarly aged non-pregnant women with COVID-19 were detected. Specifically, fever and myalgia were less common among pregnant women. Although based on a limited number of studies included for meta-analysis, authors reported an increased likelihood of admission to intensive care unit and a need for invasive ventilation among pregnant women compared with non-pregnant women with COVID-19. These associations were stronger when comparing pregnant women with COVID-19 to pregnant women without COVID-19, especially for admission to the intensive care unit. Mortality due to COVID-19 was low among pregnant women. The study also showed that pregnant women might have a higher odds of preterm birth, and that neonates born to women with COVID-19 may have a higher odds of admission to a neonatal intensive care unit. Lastly, findings from the systematic review showed that risk factors for severe COVID-19 during pregnancy included older maternal age, high body mass index, and underlying medical conditions like chronic hypertension and pre-existing diabetes. Next slide, please. Now I'm going to review several recent CDC analyses and publications. In late September, a pair of MMWR reports were released, which examined outcomes among hospitalized pregnant women. The first report on the left side of this slide is from the COVID-19 Associated Hospitalization Surveillance Network, or COVIDNET, which conducts population-based surveillance for laboratory-confirmed COVID-19 associated hospitalizations in 14 states, and it encompasses 99 counties. From March 1st to August 22nd, among nearly 600 hospitalized pregnant women with COVID-19, just under half were symptomatic. Among the symptomatic women, 16% were admitted to intensive care and 8% required invasive mechanical ventilation. Among completed pregnancies, 99% resulted in live birth and 1% in pregnancy loss. Of pregnant women who delivered a live birth during a COVID-19 associated hospitalization, the proportion of preterm deliveries was 13%. This was approximately three times higher among symptomatic women at 23% than among those who did not report symptoms at 8%. A second MWR report was an analysis by the Vaccine Safety Data Link, which is a collaboration between CDC Immunization Safety Office and 9 U.S. healthcare organizations, serving more than 12 million people each year. During March 1st through May 30th of this year, as part of the VSD or Vaccine Safety Data Link surveillance of COVID-19 hospitalizations, 105 hospitalized pregnant women with COVID-19 were identified. Of these, 41% were hospitalized for treatment of their COVID-19 illness. 3 out of 10 pregnant women admitted for COVID-19 without a pregnancy-related reason required intensive care, and 1 pregnant woman died from COVID-19. Among 93 women who delivered, stillbirths occurred in 3% or 3 of the pregnancies, and 97% were live births. Among live births, 12% were preterm. In this study, preterm delivery and stillbirth rates were higher among women with COVID-19, regardless of symptoms, and compared to background rates in the VSD catchment area during the same time period. Next slide, please. So next, I will discuss a couple of analyses and publications that came out in early November, on November 2nd. In October, we analyzed CDC's national COVID-19 case surveillance data to assess if pregnancy was associated with severe illness from COVID-19. This was an update from an analysis that we had previously done. From January 22nd to October 3rd, CDC received reports of approximately 1.3 million women aged 15 to 44 years with laboratory-confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection. Data on pregnancy status were available for approximately 460,000 of these women. And among these women, 7% or about 30,000 were reported as pregnant. 77% of pregnant women were reported as symptomatic, while 89% of non-pregnant women were reported as symptomatic. Next slide, please. We assessed 4 outcomes in this analysis: ICU admission, receipt of mechanical or invasive ventilation, receipt of extracorporeal membrane oxygenation or ECMO, and death. We restricted the analysis to women who had symptoms of COVID-19. This was to help ensure that reports of the 4 outcomes of interest among pregnant women were related to COVID-19 rather than a pregnancy-associated complication among an asymptomatic woman. After adjusting for age, race, ethnicity, and presence of pre-existing conditions, pregnant women were 3 times more likely to be admitted to the ICU compared to non-pregnant women, 2.9 times more likely to have received invasive ventilation, 2.4 times more likely to have received ECMO, and 74% more likely to have died. Next slide, please. So weekly, CDC updates the number of pregnant women with lab-confirmed COVID-19 based on the national case surveillance data. As of last week, we reported 40,406 lab-confirmed cases of COVID-19 among pregnant women and 54 deaths. And then this was updated as of yesterday as well, and we are now reporting 42,268 cases and 55 deaths. The website also provides cases by selected demographics, age, race, ethnicities, and indicators for the severe illness outcomes that I previously mentioned. Next slide, please. So in addition to the national case surveillance data, we are collecting birth and infant outcomes data among pregnant women with lab-confirmed COVID-19 through CDC's Surveillance for Emerging Threats to Mothers and Babies Network, or SETNET. SETNET was adapted from the U.S. Zika Pregnancy and Infant Registry and was designed to serve as a preparedness network that could be leveraged should a new threat emerge. So it has now been adapted to include COVID-19. The map on the left shows the 16 jurisdictions that contributed data on pregnant women with confirmed COVID-19 to SETNET as of October 14, 2020, and were included in a recent published analysis. And as of October, there were 5,252 pregnant women with lab-confirmed COVID-19 reported to SETNET. Pregnancy outcome was known for 84% of these women, or 4,442 women. Of those with known pregnancy outcomes and with data on trimester of infection, 85% of infections occurred in third trimester, 15% in the second, and less than 1% in the third trimester of pregnancy. Next slide, please. Among the 4,442 women with SARS-CoV-2 infection in pregnancy with a known pregnancy outcome, 9% had asymptomatic infection, 52% had reported symptoms, and 39% were missing data on symptom status. Among the 3,912 live births with data on gestational age reported to CETNET, 12.9% of infants were born preterm. This is higher than the national estimate of 10.2% in 2019, suggesting that women with COVID-19 during pregnancy might be at risk for preterm delivery. Next slide, please. So following this first publication of birth and infant outcomes from COVID-19 CETNET data, we launched a monthly reporting webpage. As of November 19th, we are reporting 5,775 completed pregnancies from 17 jurisdictions. Among 4,740 live born infants with information on gestational age, 12.1% were born preterm. We are continuing to update this page and additional data analyses as we continue to monitor this outbreak and pandemic. Next slide, please. I think the next slide, let me see. I have one more slide in my set, but perhaps it's not consistent. So I will say that we have, in addition to public health surveillance, CDC is supporting multiple investigations, including seroprevalence and cohort studies, to better understand the impact of COVID-19 during pregnancy on both the mother and infant. Data collected as part of these efforts can help.
I think we just lost the audio on Dr. Ellington. Dr. Ellington, you are muted.
Can you hear me now?
Now I hear you again.
Okay, I'm sorry. Is there a next slide?
Not for your presentation, it doesn't look like.
Okay, maybe it got lost. So I just, so the key takeaway points from the presentation are that based on the current data we have, pregnant people are at increased risk of severe illness from COVID-19 compared to non-pregnant people. The data also suggests that preterm birth is higher than expected among pregnant people. And pregnancy loss, specifically stillbirth, has been observed with some evidence that this may be higher than expected. Although there are limited data, we're continuing to monitor illness severity and evaluate birth and infant outcomes among pregnant women with COVID-19. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ellington. Our next speaker is Dr. Ruth Faden from Johns Hopkins. Dr. Faden, are you on?
Okay, can you hear me now?
I hear you, Dr. Faden. You have the floor.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if I've got video, but that's not important as long as the slides are showing. So thank you for this opportunity to present to NVAC. We're really grateful for it. Could I have the next slide, please? This is just an acknowledgement slide. I have no conflicts of interest. This work is supported by a grant from the Wellcome Trust. Our project is called the COVER Project, and you can see here my co-investigators and colleagues on that project. Next slide, please. I am going to skip this entirely because we just had an excellent and much more authoritative presentation than I could give about the risk to pregnant women and to their offspring from COVID-19 disease that Dr. Ellington just provided. So let's just assume we've all listened attentively to what she has to say. And of course, we have more authoritative voices coming after me. So let's just assume that pregnant women are indeed more likely to have severe outcomes and that some pregnant women are probably at elevated risk within the group of pregnant women because of something about them in addition to their pregnancy. Could I have the next slide, please? So the work that our COVER project is doing now builds on the work of a previous group called the PREVENT Working Group that released the PREVENT guidance in 2019. This is the work of an interdisciplinary international team of experts across a range of disciplines that were brought together in the wake of the Zika crisis to address how best to advance the interests of pregnant women and their offspring in the development and deployment of vaccines for emerging and re-emerging diseases, with a particular eye on the equity gap, the gap in evidence available for pregnant women and other population groups. Next slide, please. That group made 22 recommendations. The PREVENT group did, grouped into three areas: preparedness, R&D, and vaccine delivery. Next slide, please. We were working with a certain vision of the world, which I'd like to share. It's kind of nice to envision where you want to get to. And the where we want to get to and where we hope we are making progress towards is a world in which pregnant people are not unjustifiably excluded from participating in vaccine studies, a world in which pregnant women and their offspring benefit from advances in vaccine technologies and are not left behind as new vaccine products are developed, and also a world in which pregnant people have access to safe and effective vaccines to protect them and their offspring in real time against emerging and re-emerging pathogenic threats. So that's our hope. Now, please go on to the next slide. Thank you. We quickly, well, I wouldn't say so quickly, but we fairly quickly came to a shorthand way of expressing the diagnosis of the problem. And we came to call this the presumption of inclusion. It's kind of a vicious self-perpetuating cycle in which pregnant women are precluded from the evaluative design research work in the development of new vaccines because of ethical concerns, because of concerns about liability, and frankly, because a kind of inertia had set in which pregnant women were just not considered or thought about in the development of R&D, the R&D of vaccines, with the notable exception of maternal immunizations, where the vaccines are developed specifically for the target group of pregnant women. But excluding that set aside for maternal immunization, pregnancy targeted vaccines, pregnant women have been by and large excluded from R&D for vaccine development for emerging and re-emerging infections. The lack of data from the research phase has resulted in a lack of evidence, which then has resulted in exclusion or delay of pregnant women from rollout and programmatic delivery programs. And that then itself becomes another source of lack of information or data. So you get this perpetuated cycle of exclusion and evidence gaps that perpetuates itself from research to program, to research, to program over and over again. And we end up with just nowhere near the information we should have on products and platforms. Next slide, please. Our prescription, in a nutshell, is to shift the presumption from a presumption of exclusion to a presumption of inclusion. The idea here is that we should strive in all cases for the appropriate, and we can talk more about what that means, but the appropriate inclusion of pregnant women in the research phase of development of new vaccines for emerging and re-emerging threats. The appropriate inclusion as early as possible then results in better evidence about safety and immunogenicity, which then allows for the appropriate inclusion of pregnant women in vaccine campaigns, which then allows for enhanced evidence for use in future outbreaks. And what you get is, instead of a pernicious, vicious cycle, if you like, you get a virtuous cycle in which greater knowledge about platforms, adjuvants, and vaccine technologies then go on to inform future research and future use and take us closer to that envisioned positive future. Next slide, please. I want to pause here on one particular step on the way to the inclusion of attempts to evaluate candidate vaccines with pregnant people, and that is the necessity from a regulatory point of view of conducting DART studies, non-clinical studies, before regulatory authorities will generally permit pregnant people to be included in any way in the evaluation of an investigational vaccine. One of our major recommendations was that DART studies be initiated ideally right after the end of a phase one evaluation of a candidate as it moves on, a promising candidate, from phase one to phase two, so that we would have the DART data in hand, hopefully favorable DART data, as soon as it becomes appropriate to expand our evaluative investigation to pregnant women. Next slide, please. This is borrowed, and I apologize for the tiny text here, but I'll decode it for you. It's borrowed and updated from a slide that Dr. Oliver presented, I think last month, And basically, if I can draw your attention, although I think I do need to decode it, to the DART row for the leading candidates, those that are closest to EU authorization, what you could see, if you could see here, is that none of the drug developers have thus far reported any DART data. They all indicate that DART studies are underway. Of the two candidate vaccines that are of immediate interest, Moderna is saying that it will be reporting DART data in the first quarter of 2021. You may have more accurate information than we do on this point, or more up-to-date information, but that would be fairly soon. And the Pfizer-BioNTech developers are saying that the DART data are being collected, but have not given an indication of, as far as we know, at least that we can find, of when that data will be available. The AZ vaccine with Oxford has reported anyway that they plan to release DART data by the end of quarter four 2020. So that would be super soon. But so far, no DART data have been reported. Next slide, please. So as we work our way through the questions of whether or under what conditions, which is the way we would rather phrase it, under what conditions is it acceptable to begin evaluating an investigational vaccine directly in pregnant women? And similarly, when is it acceptable to offer pregnant women a COVID-19 vaccine as part of a public health vaccination program? We're obviously in a context in which we are balancing the prospect of benefit against the risk. Next slide, please. Among the factors that need to be taken into account in making this risk-benefit assessment specific to pregnancy are the prospects for vaccine protection, the risk of harm from infection, from community-acquired infection, the likelihood of infection, the risk of harm from vaccination, and the availability and alternatives, the availability of alternative preventives and treatments. Next slide, please. Just to make this a little bit more particular to pregnancy, at least right now, with respect to both Pfizer and Moderna, it appears as if, and I'm clearly, I'm saying this to the, to the relevant experts and authorities here, but it does look as if we have a prospect of a very efficacious vaccine. So the prospect of vaccine protection is high. The risk of harm from infection, we have heard Dr. Ellington describe, so I won't review that here. The risk of harm from vaccination is the black box. And so where considerable discussion and analysis and thinking is happening right now, both in terms of what theoretically might be possible and what could be learned quickly from DART studies, if anything, and from other kinds of investigation. These other two factors, likelihood of infection and availability of alternative preventives and treatments, very much co-travel. And here, the main point I want to make is an obvious one, but it bears repeating. And that is that pregnant women are not one homogeneous group of people. Pregnant women obviously vary in terms of the likelihood that they could become infected, the likelihood that they would become seriously ill if they became infected, and the extent to which they are positioned to be able to avail themselves of opportunities to reduce their risk of infection through, for example, physical distancing and some combination of sheltering. And so here, just to underscore the point, for pregnant women who are able to work from home or who do not work outside the home and who live in housing that does not put them in close quarters with many people who must work outside the home, the alternative of essentially sheltering until the pregnancy is completed is a possibility. For pregnant women who live in crowded housing conditions, multiple multi-generational or multi-numbers of people in small spaces, in compact communities, who must work outside the home, either because of financial necessity, professional duty, or both, the prospect of being able to shelter themselves from risk of infection just evaporates. And I don't need to say, but maybe I should, that the conditions I've just described disproportionately are the case for women who are low income, for women of color, from poor communities, and for disadvantaged groups generally. With respect to the availability of alternative treatments, I just want to flag, although this is not the right group to think about this, say it's not your remit, that there are interesting ethics questions about whether if pregnant women are not afforded opportunity to protect themselves with vaccine for some period of time when other people who are otherwise like them are, it raises the question of whether they should be at the top of the queue for treatments should they become infected and ill with COVID-19 disease. And that raises the question, for example, about what we know, about certain of the newer treatments in pregnancy. Next slide, please. One other point I want to underscore is at each stage of decision-making about whether or how to expose or offer the opportunity to be exposed to to COVID-19 vaccine for a pregnant woman or pregnant women, it's very important that the right people be around the table. So we have been pushing all the way through that experts in maternal and perinatal health, in pediatrics and in research ethics and in public health ethics when it comes to the deployment decision, as well as people who are in positions to speak for pregnant people directly or representationally, be involved in that decision. Next slide, please. And with that, I thank you and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, Dr. Faden. Our next speaker is Dr. Jeff Roberts from FDA. Dr. Roberts, you have the floor.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, you're loud and clear.
Great. So it's good to be with you this afternoon. I'm going to give an update that's organized based on the topics that we covered in the guidance for industry that we issued in June around clinical development of the COVID vaccines generally. And in that guidance document, we address pregnancy in several times according to several different topics. So I will talk about an update according to those different topics. It's a nice segue from what Ruth was raising earlier about developmental and reproductive toxicology studies, or DART studies. This was a strong recommendation in our guidance document that these studies be done as quickly as possible. I can tell you as an update that they are nearing completion, but they will almost certainly not be ready to be reviewed and labeled in time for the labeling that you will see in association with an emergency use authorization or EUA, should there be one. We're very close, and those labels will almost certainly be updated to include those data when they become available, but they will not, almost certainly not be available at the time of initial EUA. So another area we addressed in our guidance document was to encourage all the sponsors during their preclinical studies to follow all pregnant women and document outcomes in the infants. As you know, a pregnancy has been an exclusion criteria in these trials. Women were tested for pregnancy before being vaccinated each time. In those programs, despite those measures, women are frequently vaccinated very early, or they're vaccinated very early in pregnancy, and we get a few pregnancies like that in these large pre-licensure trials. That's inevitable. We know that very well from the large trials that were done in HPV. That has happened again to a small degree in these trials. But there are very few pregnancies to data to review, and most of those pregnancies are not yet completed. So we're not going to have data on that either in this early phase of EUA and or licensure. Now, another topic that we raise in our guidance document is that we recommended to the sponsors that they both consider including women in the trials who are not actively avoiding pregnancy, and we recommended that they conduct specific studies in pregnant women. Now, these are really two different undertakings, and they give you different sets of data. And in the first case, it models what we're likely to see in, for example, a nationwide program that includes healthcare workers, because there will be inevitable inadvertent vaccinations that occur in pregnancy before women were knew that they were pregnant. And so we still think it's important, if possible, to remove that exclusion criteria in pre-licensure trials and to start to get those sorts of data. In the latter case, conducting studies specifically in pregnancy are typically done once women already know they're pregnant. They are sometimes targeted to a specific trimester, like the second or third trimester, and they give you an entirely different set of safety data. So we think that both of those are still very important, but in both cases, DART study data, we feel, are necessary to support the safety of initiating those types of studies. So we don't yet have those DART data, and those studies have not been initiated yet. So the other thing we talk about in the guidance is importance of evaluating the safety post EUA or post licensure through pregnancy registry studies or other types of study designs. And all of those approaches are areas of active discussions internally and externally. What I thought I would do finally is to talk about labeling a little bit. It has been an area of confusion essentially since we've started talking about maternal immunization from a regulatory perspective many years ago. So in some cases, some vaccines are contraindicated. They have a warning on the front page of the label under contraindications that indicate that the vaccine should not be used during pregnancy. In most cases, those are live attenuated viruses that are the basis of the vaccine. And those viruses are, for example, in the case of MMR, known to be teratogenic with respect to the wild type virus. So those types of associations and data that support contraindications in pregnancy are the case in for some vaccines. But if we, in the absence of those types of data or those concerns, those safety signals, then the vaccine is generally not contraindicated. And we don't consider use in pregnancy to be quote unquote off label, which you'll hear talked about quite a bit. Because the indication for use is inclusive of a population in that age range, both males and females. So that is not considered to be off-label use. So it's important to really understand that basic perspective. And then I think we can start to talk about what the contrasts are between our approach and the approach of other groups like the ACIP. But one that I think is really important and that we may want to talk about, we've already had some discussion, some questions externally about the approach that the UK's regulatory authority, MHRA, took in labeling with respect to pregnancy and breastfeeding. In that label, they recommend against both pregnancy and breastfeeding, and even recommend testing prior to administration of the vaccine. Our labels generally, and I would say now almost across the board, do not include recommendations. And there's a good reason for that recommendations can change based on new data. And our labels are generally reserved for displaying the data that we that has been submitted to us and agreed upon with the manufacturer as being adequate to support the benefit risk perspective for use in any given population. So we generally do not include recommendations in our label. And I can tell you that almost certainly we are going to stick with that, and our labels will not include recommendations with respect to use in pregnancy or breastfeeding. So we will label the data that we have in hand as we get it. So I think that is enough for now for me in terms of an update, and I want to leave time for discussion if people have questions. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Roberts. Next will be Dr. Linda Eckert from the University of Washington, representing ACOG. Dr. Eckert, you have the floor. I think you're muted, please.
Great, thank you. Thank you now very much for this participation in this panel, which has just been excellent so far. I'm talking representing the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology, or ACOG. Next slide, please. And just a little brief background about ACOG. It's a nonprofit membership organization that contains 95% of board certified OBGYNs in this country. And of course, we are a major source of ambulatory care for women and do attend 85% of deliveries in the United States. Next slide, please. So ACOG in 2010 convened an immunization expert work group as OBGYNs were called to become vaccinators more commonly, with increasing products being used in our patient population. And over the years, this group has expanded to include a range of infectious disease and emerging infection public health preparedness guidance. The members of the ACOG Immunization and Infectious Disease Expert Group are recognized experts in infectious diseases and the immunization, and have had various roles both nationally and internationally, and are well represented as liaisons across the sphere of immunization work. And this work group has been integral to ACOG's response to COVID-19 as it was to the response to Zika. Next slide, please. ACOG has worked extremely hard on COVID-19 response efforts. There's been 4 independent work groups that have focused on ethics, GYN, OB, and telehealth. There's been practice advisories. There's been very frequent updates of frequently asked questions for clinicians and patients. Next slide. And the ACOG group is working currently on recommendations for use of COVID-19 vaccines. The development of these vaccine recommendations for pregnant women is being led by the ACOG Immunization Expert Work Group, and also will be reviewed by different work groups within ACOG as well. And the last meeting that we had as a large group was on November 16th, where we had a very robust discussion about these recommendations. But I would say that there's nearly weekly calls, updates, very frequent emails, trying to stay abreast of things that are happening in this rapidly evolving space. Next slide. So ACOG was asked by ACIP to make a comment, and the ACOG considerations that went into the ACIP comment were the idea that we've talked about here, that pregnant patients are at increased risk of severe illness. As we know, they have not been included, but that they do make up a significant portion of the top priority groups, including, as Dr. Faden spoke to, the idea that many pregnant patients are also the same people that have faced increased risk due to systemic barriers within the healthcare system. And we, of course, also acknowledge that these mRNA vaccines are new, and we don't have a background of historical data on safety and efficacy to fall back on. Next slide. But in light of those things and taking them still into consideration, the ACOG statement that we presented at ACIP was that pregnant and lactating individuals who otherwise fit the criteria for inclusion in the high priority population should not be excluded from receiving a vaccine. Now, clearly, this is before an EUA is stated, and if the EUA is silent or permissive for pregnancy, we would continue to hold this position. Also, that the decision to vaccinate a pregnant patient should be based on the risk-benefit conversation with the patient and the clinical care team. And again, I think Dr. Faden had a really wonderful slide about all those different risk-benefit components. The other thing I would like to add is that ACOG does feel that we would like to try to disconnect pregnancy and lactation. These are almost always stated together in the same sentence, but they actually have a very different, we would consider, risk profile. And so that would be another point for discussion. Next slide. And so with that, I will stop and allow other panelists to speak and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Eckert. At this point, I think Dr. Mini Delman and Dr. Odebeyu are just are available for questions. So I will open up the floor to any members of the committee with questions or comments. You would either unmute yourself or announce yourself on the chat. I will be happy to recognize you.
Bob, Cody Meissner here.
Please, Cody, go ahead.
Two questions, thank you. I have a question for Ruth Faden and for Jeff Roberts. And thank you all for very interesting presentations. So Dr. Faden, this spring there was a publication and regarding vaccination with Novartis's nanoparticle vaccine in pregnant women to protect against RSV, the idea being that a woman would boost her immunity, antibodies would be passed on to the baby. And in fact, it didn't reach the primary endpoint, but the results were really quite promising. Gita's must be it's Novavax, not Novartis. And I know Novavax is working on a SARS-CoV-2 vaccine. It'll be a protein affected. And it seems to me that that would make sense to use that in pregnant women, since we already have some preliminary data about a safety vaccine, the safety of that vaccine. And then the second question I'll just put out there, because Jeff Robertson and for anyone else, one concern that's been expressed with these messenger RNA vaccines during pregnancy, particularly in the first trimester, is could that RNA somehow become incorporated into the DNA of the fetus when there is so much cell replication going on? We don't ordinarily think of an RNA-dependent DNA polymerase being around, but what happens if there's a retrovirus? Is that just a completely unlikely scenario? Over.
Ruth, you are muted. You need to come off mute so we can hear you.
You're on mute, please.
Okay.
There you go.
There you
go. Can you hear me?
I hear you now.
Can you hear me now? Okay, great. So I should go ahead?
Please.
So, all right. So thank you, Dr. Maynard. And let me just distinguish my expertise from those of others. So I'm going to leave it to Gita and others, both on the committee and in the panel, to address the question of whether the Novavax vaccine, if there's reason to think, because of past experience, prior use of a similar platform, that it is a safer vaccine for pregnant women than, say, the mRNA vaccines. But what I will say is the following from an ethics point of view. From the standpoint of the interests of pregnant women right now, those that are currently pregnant will want an answer, especially if they are in high risk of infection contexts, will want an answer to the question of whether they're able to take, permitted to make a decision to take the vaccine that's on offer now. And the vaccine that is on offer, presumably, I don't want to get ahead of Dr. Roberts and the FDA, but let's just envision you're a pregnant person and it's, you know, December 28th and the FDA has taken its decision and your health system has started to, it's one of the four areas that's going to get vaccine early, it's going to roll out and you're at the beginning of your third trimester and you're working in the health system and the people around you are similar in similar risk and they want it, they're getting vaccinated. And the ethics sort of fairness question is what should be permitted with respect to that, those pregnant workers. We can't tell them wait for the Novavax vaccine to come out because they won't be pregnant anymore. So the issue that we're facing in the near term is a very specific one, which is how to address the claims of the pregnant people who are right now concerned about whether they should be offered vaccine, whether they should make that decision or not. I'm not giving you the answer. I'm just saying that it may be that in several months' time, we will have a good vaccine from the standpoint comparatively for pregnant women that the consensus of the people who are expert on the technical questions agree is better than some of the others. But for right now, that's not right now what we're facing. So we don't have an immediate near term technical fix to the ethics challenge.
So I'll just pick it up there with respect to the other question that Cody asked. And I think it's a good one, and it's one amongst many theoretical concerns that we've thought about. What I'll say is that at least for us internally, there is some degree of reassurance in that the mRNA products are not entirely new in terms of clinical development programs. That technology has gone forward to one degree or another in several different clinical development programs. Zika is a good example. So we have some safety data in humans prior to even embarking on the COVID vaccine studies. And in some of those previous programs, we even do have some DARTS data that can be used to evaluate to some degree that specific question you asked, Cody. And I would say that at least for us so far, those data have been reassuring with respect to that question.
Thank you. Gita, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, thanks, Bob. So I just want to say to one point about Cody's question about the Novavax vaccine platform, which is the baculovirus expression vector. So the only issue is that in those studies, so while it's true that we have data, quite frankly, on many, many pregnant women that received that vaccine, keep in mind that was an alum adjuvanted vaccine. The COVID vaccine with Novavax now is actually a proprietary M-matrix adjuvant. And that is something that, as you know, we've had lots and lots of discussions about adjuvants in even in pediatric vaccines and also in pregnant women. We have not yet so far licensed or approved of any products. The only adjuvant and vaccine experience we really have in pregnancy would have been back from H1N1. Probably with, and Len would probably know this data better than me, but maybe with ASO3 or with one of the novel vaccine, H1N1 vaccines in the EU or in Europe at the time. So I think it would be great if we could use data that we have from other locations, but I'm not sure we're necessarily going to be able to just pick one over the other. And to kind of reiterate Ruth's points and the things that both Ruth Faden and Linda Eckert pointed out, is that I think from the ethical standpoint, all of this information is something that an adult woman who happens to be pregnant should, I think, still be offered the opportunity to consider. I'll stop there. Thanks.
Thank you, Gita. Lynn also posted the comment that protein vaccines like HPV have a strong history of safety experience in pregnant women also. Are there any other questions or comments from members of the committee? Any comments that Dr. Mimi Delman or Dr. Odoyebo would like to make? All right, well, thank
you. Dana Mimi Delman. I just want to thank the presenters. I know it's been a robust discussion, and as you heard from others, we are awaiting the EUA, and then ACIP will discuss this at one of their upcoming meetings. Thanks.
Certainly. Thank you. All right. Well, we have reached our time of a break. We're going to take a break now from 2:45 to 3 p.m. Eastern time, at which time we'll return for a discussion on vaccine safety systems and COVID-19. Thank you all for your participation in this December 4th meeting to address our charge from the Assistant Secretary, and we'll be back on in 15 minutes promptly. Thank you.
Thank you.